So at what age did you start performing in bands and traveling?
Somewhere between the age of seven and 10, I believe I played my first job with him. Right after I learned how to play a little bit, maybe about somewhere between 7 and 10. I do remember that I started to play with him professionally around the age of 9 or 10.
And now at that age, did you start, you know, is that when you started playing like the cornet and instruments like that?
Yes, I started playing the cornet once he showed me what it looked like, and he found some old horns in the basement of a college, Natchez Junior College in Natchez, and we started to play and travel around Mississippi and Louisiana. And I started to travel with him when I was in, it was during the days of, what was it? That must have been 1949, well before you two were born. And we started to play little ball games, concerts, and whatever, with people from the age of like 21 down to my age, which is about 9 or 10 years old.
Okay. Now, how did your parents, you know, feel about you traveling and playing in bands at such a young age? I mean, were they supportive of that?
Yeah, in those days, you had to do what they asked you to do. They never said anything about it. They never said anything about it except give the professor kinds, give him a little money if he gives you some. And I would give him all of my money. And I learned later that I didn't have to give him all of my money, just some of it.
That was your first style of business in music, huh?
Yeah, that's when I started with him. Yeah.
Okay.
He was a very brilliant man. And I would take him sandwiches and stuff like that. He didn't have any food or anything like that. He just gave lessons. We didn't have a typing in town those days, but he started.
Right.
Yeah, he started teaching typing also, and he married a girl that he was instructing. The girl was about 14 years old, or maybe a little younger, and he married her right away, and he moved into his own house, and I played with him until I was about, I guess about 8th grade. And it didn't allow him to teach school because he had no papers at all.
Oh.
So he got a music teacher at school, and I joined the band in high school, and I guess later on, after I left town and went to look for him, he had moved on to another college called Alcorn College, about 30 miles away from where we lived. And before he left for the college, he became the president of the junior college.
Wow.
Yeah, he did. And after that, he started to work at Alcorn College as a teacher.
He was able to do that without actually having, went for any education or anything like that. That was just based on his talent.
Yeah, based on his talent. And he didn't have to have many papers of anything in those days. No, you didn't need a driver's license or anything, you know, except for the high school. They would not employ him at high school because of those papers and on and on.
Okay.
That's all it was. And then I moved away to Nashville, Tennessee State University. I went to a little college there to join the band. The band was an excellent high school band. An excellent college band. Carlsbad, and we played different kinds of music there. A lot of jazz, a lot of classical music, you know, Ravel, and the marching band, of course. And a lot of music from those days, jazz music that I got attuned to during that time.
Now, which vocalist or jazz or any other artist influenced you growing up?
Well, I didn't listen to jazz in those days. We just played stuff, music that was on the radio. Yeah, stuff that was written maybe in the 30s or whatever like that. And I learned about jazz by listening to records. When I went to college, I listened to it all the time. I never heard those records, and the musicians from larger towns. I met a lot of musicians from those places like Memphis and Nashville and the southern, the larger towns in the south. And most of those musicians had records. I never had records when I grew up, maybe one or two, but not listening to jazz at all. Mm-hmm. And I think I'd heard one jazz record before I left town. There was one record in town on the jukebox in a little nightclub. There was one record that I listened to and one record until it was all damaged and scratched, you know. That was about it.
Now, what kind of music was that back then?
I do remember that. You mean before I listened to jazz?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All rhythm and blues and blues.
Okay.
That was it. And a little
now,
music. Go ahead.
Now, can you explain to me, like, what is different between jazz music and rhythm and blues?
Well, jazz was basically sounds from European instruments, trumpets, saxophones, piano, stuff like that. But the other music was all vocal with guitars, a few pianos and drums and bass. That was it. But we were not involved in playing jazz music in those days, at least during my time. Because I heard that we had played jazz there in my hometown a few years before I was born. And things had changed by that time. And there was no jazz at all to speak of, just blues clubs, a few little juke joints and things like that. But we never heard of the jazz at all. I didn't hear jazz until I was in college. That was about it.
When you were in college for pre-med, huh?
Yeah. Sure did.
Now, what happened with that? How did you go from pre-med and then ended up being the great musician that you are today?
Well, once I got to college, I lost interest in those courses, biology and things like that, all those things. And I decided to change my major to music and composition, vocal music and compositional music. And I did that for a couple of years. And I got bored with college and the environment itself. So I decided to leave college and go and join the Navy and enroll into the Navy School of Music. So I left, joined the Navy and traveled around the world for 4 years. And I spent a lot of time in Europe, the islands, and Africa. And Cuba. And I did 4 years of that in Newport, Rhode Island. I did my last year in New York City. That's how I wound up in New York City.
So because of the Navy, that's how you ended up. Okay, that was our next question, actually. We were curious how you made it up to New York. So
yeah.
Now, but how did you end up staying in New York? What made you stay here and not go back to, you know, either Mississippi or, you know, Tennessee, you know, places like that that you were used to?
Yeah, because it was a little too slow for me. My mind was always looking for something else. And
okay.
New York was a place that it was wide open to move around. It was large and had many different experiences here in New York. So I decided to stay. Of course, my mother invited me back to come back to Mississippi and finish college. And there was nothing in mind for me to do to leave New York and go to Mississippi because it was small towns and I'd had enough of that. There was quite a bit of a repression down there, and there was nothing to do. So it was much freer for me to come into New York and live.
Okay, makes sense. Now, at that point when you were in New York, did you have it in your mind that you were going to try to pursue music as a career, more on it as a career?
No, it never came to my mind, because as soon as I was discharged from the military, I found that it was very difficult to know the musicians, especially if no one knew me. And being from Mississippi, I didn't have any history of jazz and anything like that, and I had to learn my way around here. And the musicians were not very friendly during that time to new musicians who didn't have a larger city background and knowledge of jazz and whatever. And there was a lot of drugs in New York at the time, mostly heroin, heavy drugs. And it wasn't my background. I couldn't really communicate on that level at all. So I decided not to play. I didn't want to play when I got to New York anyway, because I had enough music. I had enough. I've been playing since I was 7, and it wasn't in my mind to play the music in New York, not in this environment. So I played while I was in the Navy, up until the day I was discharged from the military. And when I was discharged in New York, I had no interest in playing at all. So I didn't play. I just got various jobs doing quite a few things, working jobs at the hospital, the Navy Yard, and a Japanese newspaper company, and quite a few other things. And years passed, and I met a few musicians in Brooklyn. I was living in Brooklyn at the time. A musician named Carlos Cornett and Bill Barron, saxophone player, and they lived in my neighborhood. There were quite a few musicians who lived in Brooklyn. I had a little car. When I stopped driving a little while and started to walk, I learned that I was living in a musician full of musicians, and I would always go and see them play at all times. They were all professional. Quite a few of them had records and stuff like that, so I knew who they were. And I would go down and see them play in a little nightclub called the Blue Cornet in Brooklyn, and another place called the Studio O. And I would go to Manhattan every now and then, very seldom, but I would go every now and then to the Birdland and the Fire Spot, and I would get a chance to meet a lot of famous musicians. And I would spend my time mostly in Brooklyn, period. And so I had enough jobs that there was nothing else to do with those jobs you could get those days. So I decided to play music. And I would run into musicians on the street who remember me from college remember me from the military, and they brought me into the world of music back in New York City.
Now, after that, is that when you formed your band, the Oprah Orchestra?
Well, not right after, but later on, I started playing with all kinds of bands.
Mm-hmm.
In New York, I played with Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers and Bill Barron and Tyrone Washington. There were quite a few musicians I played with at the time. I started playing the avant-garde music, they called it that. And there were not many trumpet players who wanted to play the avant-garde music. And most of the trumpet players were bebop musicians, and they didn't like that at all, and they would not interfere with that. So that was a lot of work for me to do because of that, and that's when I formed the Oprah Orchestra after playing those situations. I didn't really like the kind of music they were playing because it wasn't my real culture, and I didn't really understand the idea of just playing just to play.
Mm-hmm.
But they were very internationally known, and they were big records, and they would call me on their record dates, and I'd go and blow a little bit, and I got kind of unnerved because of that, because my friends I knew in Brooklyn did not like or appreciate any of those styles of music. And neither did I, but I could play well enough to get myself a gig every now and then with other people. And after I got tired of that, I decided to form my own band then. Maybe 1975. I started hanging out of Brooklyn into Manhattan, which is in a whole other world at that time. It was mostly done on the Lower East Side. The gigs and everything like that, the Bowery. In those days, Soho wasn't Soho. It was just dark and dingy down there, and we would go and play in lofts at the time. And we played loft music quite a while down there. And I formed the Oprah Orchestra. I played one day. I remember I didn't have a band, but they had written down a spot for me to play at a gig called the Cartographers down on 3rd Street. The Lower East Side, 3rd Street between Avenue B and C.
Okay.
This guy's name, his name was Amos Reese. He decided to start a concert series every night. A different player would play. And I found some musicians on my way to the gig, as a matter of fact. Because I didn't know too many people that would play with me. And I ran into a musician who I saw on the street, and I formed a whole band that afternoon on my way to the gig. And I
formed the band on your way to another gig.
Exactly.
That's right. New York.
Yeah. You can only do that in New York. Especially during that time, you know. And New York was full of musicians. Ran to play music at all times. And it was a very nice situation because I could always see musicians just walking the street. And I didn't have a car at that time, so I was just walking and finding people, which became very easy to me. I thought the world was like that. You know, it's so easy to find people to play with you. And I went down there unprepared. I never liked to rehearse anyway, and I did rehearse. So I asked them to meet me down there, and since I didn't have a book of music to play, I decided to play one song, one of Miles Davis' songs, And what my idea was to play this one song using different rhythms to the same song, which in turn made it sound different to the people in the audience. And so I played this song for about an hour and a half. And my way was to play different musics. I wouldn't say different music, but different rhythms to the same song, which made it sound very different to the people. And I had a lot of knowledge of rhythms, and I used that knowledge to get through the concert just by telling them what beats to play. And every beat was a completely different beat, but with the same sound. And it was a very, very good concert for me. And it was, as a matter of fact, I got a record deal from doing that.
Really?
Yeah. And I recorded the record, and it was a very good record. And it was two records, I think, because I played the avant-garde way of playing, the way I was in that environment, so I played that way. And then I decided I didn't like that after we finished it. So Alan Douglas, I don't know if you know his name or not, but he was the producer, and he decided to allow me to do something else. So I did something else with it and brought different musicians up, more musicians. I brought a singer, a vocalist, and I started singing myself. I thought I brought in a singer, but the singer, as I was explaining my method to the singer, he was a great singer too. He said he could do it because I did a better job. I didn't think of myself as a singer at all. Well, I did it. Yeah, I did it anyway. I played trumpet. I wrote all the songs while we were in the studio. I didn't have any preparation. All the songs, and I thought it was a very good record. And we finally finished it. And I got some money out of it, but the producer disappeared on me. And haven't seen him since. And the record, of course, the record never came out. I've heard tapes of it, but I had tapes, cassette tapes of it. That's all I had. And of course, it's been around so long, the tapes just died. You know, as you know, what tapes will do for you. And they died, dissipated, and I haven't seen him or heard of him. I heard that Sting, the artist, had a record coming at the time called Pangea Records. I heard he was trying to buy it from the producer. The producer wanted to charge him $250,000 for the tapes.
Wow. Get out of here.
Yep. And see, in those days, I had a lot of musicians on the record. They were all making records. They were very famous artists of that day. And
right.
So it was like you could just cut the record up, anything you wanted to do with the record, and slice it, and it could be really sold. So I just did that. And it was too expensive for them to want to buy it, so they left it alone. And that's the last I heard of that. But
wow.
Yeah, and I phoned with this band. I never had records, and I came to like not having records because I could work more than musicians in my ilk, musicians who were recording and traveling. But I could work anywhere because my music was such that it was entertaining, and I was definitely creative about things because I would do what I wanted to do. Because I didn't have any plans made. I would just play, just do anything. You know, as long as I had a nice rhythm to it, I could play. I can make up melodies at will, so that was no problem. and I could just play where I wanted to, because I could make a song that sounded like something, that meant something. I guess it did mean something, but to me it was just something I just did automatically. And so I played all the top clubs around New York City, everywhere. I played at the shelters, I played for kids' groups. And so I was pretty well known at that time, because I could play anywhere and I could satisfy the crowd at that time. And I kept that band for quite a while. After a while, I had two bands, the Okra Orchestra and the Natchez City Band. That was a five-piece band, which I have now. And, well, not now, because I retired about a year and a half ago. So I have retired from music, you know. And
But you say you retired about a year. Like, I mean, are you 100% that you're not dealing with music at all, or are you doing like other things instead of performing?
Yeah, I did a lot of things outside of that. I spent a lot of my career writing music for black theater all over, and I also used a lot of my career as a musician, as a composer with Diane McIntyre's dance company.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we did about 30 years together. I did about 30 years in black theater until it was. What are you gonna say?
So you also performed on theater. Also, you were also in a show here, correct?
Yeah, quite a few. We did quite a few shows in New York City, of course.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and I did that till Diane got older and I got older, and she started to teach dance courses in colleges or whatever, and I would do things like that myself, and we worked together for many years. And so I got tired of music, period. I stopped traveling, and I disbanded my band, and I haven't played. Last time I played was maybe last year, one of those Central Park concerts out in Queens, and I decided to stop playing then because I wasn't feeling that well like I am now. And I got old before I knew I was old. And then somebody asked me, why aren't you playing anymore? And I realized I was 69 years old. But I wasn't thinking about how old I was at the time. I just wasn't feeling like doing anything. Mm-hmm. And then when I discovered that I was almost 70 years old, yeah, I said to myself, I've been doing this for quite a long time.
Uh-huh.
But and I started not feeling too good, and I decided to retire around that time.
Okay. Well, you've had a very, very long, you know, career history in music, and I know you've seen a lot of, you know, got a chance to see a lot of different places because of the music.
Yeah.
But you know what I want to ask, Chris? It's your most recent, you know, whatever you did most recently as far as music. I mean, if somebody asks you, you know, is it jazz? Is it blues? You know, do you, what category would it, would your music, your sound fall in?
It's something that you couldn't categorize that, because I remember when I finally did a record in 1998, I went to the music store, and I couldn't find where they had placed me because they had no categories, no place to put it in. And every store I went to, I had to look for it, because it was sometimes in jazz, sometimes it was in blues, and sometimes it was in world music. And that's why it was so difficult to find for a while. And my music was never categorized. They did it in magazines to saying I was a jazz musician. I'm known as a jazz musician only because I played with some well-known jazz musicians.
Right. I guess it was the easiest thing to be able to refer you to.
Yeah.
For people, you know, what people knew.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
But I'm not, I don't categorize myself like that because I'm not a jazz musician in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a blues musician in my mind, although I can do all those types of music.
Mm-hmm.
And
so you're just Olu Dara, very talented musician.
Yeah, well, let me write that down for a minute.
We were curious to find out, because when we listen to your music, it's not, you know, like I hear it and I won't say, well, that's jazz. You know, I mean, you have some that, you know, are more inclined towards that genre of music, but then you have other stuff that are not. So
mm-hmm.
It was just curious to, like, you know, what does he consider himself, you know? How would he describe his music? Interesting.
Yeah, I remember when they inducted me into the Hall of Fame in my home state, Mississippi. And people, the inductees were mostly people who were categorized as jazz or blues or gospel. And when I got to the stage, they had read something. Well, they did not read, but they said, I was wondering if they were going to categorize me as a jazz or blues musician.
Mm-hmm.
And they did not. And I was very happy about this. The award was Olu Dara musician. And that was a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was a very nice thing for me to do, very insightful.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I am. I spent a lot of time on stage, like I was saying, in theater, as a performer, as an actor, as a writer. And most of the music you hear from me on those records were songs I'd written when I was dealing with theater. So I took the songs and made them recordable.
Right.
Because a lot of those songs were just some of the artists on stage, just all vocal, and some just guitar and me singing them, or the people in the theater group. And I took them and I put that on records and with a whole band, and that's all you're hearing. You're hearing stuff that came from the theater.
Okay.
And those, what are you saying?
No, I said that's cool. It's an interesting concept how you did that, because if you wouldn't have done that, who knows? Like, you probably, there's been so many songs that nobody would have ever heard.
Mm-hmm.
You're right about that. I could have wound up being called a jazz musician or a blues musician.
Because
they would call me, they always call me for jazz groups, to play the jazz group or play jazz or play blues, or, you know, play with a blues musician. And I was way away from that kind of stuff. I never was in it anyway. But that's what they wanted me to do, and I everything was laid out really for me to do. I didn't have to plan anything. It just came out that way.
If there's one particular moment throughout your whole career that stands out the most to you, what would it be?
Well, playing in shelters and stuff like that. Or playing in a rhythm and blues band when I first got to New York, which is my favorite genre.
Okay.
In those days, I was playing rhythm and blues, live rhythm and blues, in New York City and all over. And not just New York City, but just this area. Queens, New York, Brooklyn, that's where I did it. And after a while, the rhythm and blues became a thing of the past. As you see now, you know, you may see it. Oh, and the hip hop stuff like that, you may see that on television. It's still, you can't really find rhythm and blues joints in Manhattan at all. Or either other places.
Mm-hmm.
You understand that, right? So
that's
something I really missed, because there was so much enjoyment just the idea that I played for people who came out to see us to have fun, you know, which is completely different from jazz and blues in New York, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I enjoy that because people come out of their houses and people who never went out other than just weekends and some private little places where people go and sit, talk, and dance, you know, and sing and whatever like that. And when that was gone, that was nothing for me to find. I didn't want to really get into the rhythm and blues recording game because that was it wasn't my type of living anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I never did find any type. I didn't find any type of musical living to be enjoyable to me. I thought the jazz world was too. It was too. I don't know what it was. I did it a lot, but I never got anything out of it. And the blues in New York was not. You can hardly find it. They have a sense of shame when it comes to blues, or they like to categorize them as just country boys who play guitars or whatever like that. So it didn't fit my life at all. Neither one of them. I didn't really enjoy the idea of being a jazz musician or blues or anything like that. So theater was my world, I believe, and that's probably why my songs are come from theater, because it was between jazz and blues somewhere. In between it all.
Right. So now, what do you feel? What do you think about music that's, you know, like out now? I mean, let's probably talk a little bit more about maybe like the hip hop world. How do you feel about that genre of music?
Well, it has a lot to do with what was happening now, and I enjoyed that because of what it was, and I was very. Connected with that because of where I moved my boys out to Queensbridge when they were little babies, and they became hip hop artists, and they seemed to take in that world, all of it, the whole world. It was more real to me than all the other music that I've been involved with. And I've been around them and watched them go from A to Z with that. And there's quite a bit of that music that I can really relate to. I don't really listen to a lot of the music because there's a lot of work. It's got to do with words and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Every now and then I hear some words that make sense to me. And I don't really listen to a lot of words anyway. Even when I had my own band, I just started talking. I really didn't have any idea. It didn't mean anything to me. Words never meant too much to me when it came to me.
Your form of expression was more through the actual sound and the music.
That's it, Derek. Look, let me write that down, too. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, no, but I mean, I understand what you mean, because it's even like we're talking about hip hop and even other genre of music that's out there. Sometimes, you know, if you mute the sound, you know, the
words,
vocals.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, if the music was produced right or, you know, composed well, you could almost tell the story just by listening to this music alone. Which, me myself, I feel like this is not enough of that nowadays. I don't feel like they're putting too much effort into the actual music, you know?
No, as a matter of fact, I feel the same way. They don't. They go, because words, you know, words are like. No matter what they say, you've heard it before.
Right.
And music is, if you get down to music, it can bring you other information, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I always listen, even when I was listening to jazz, back in the day, I could just listen to the music and forget about what they're trying to say. And when they used words, it didn't sound like jazz to me at all. It had to do with some kind of something that they expected people to call jazz, but it was just another type of jazz lyrics comes from maybe popular music of the day at that time.
Right.
But it didn't have much to say. Not to me, it didn't have much to say, so I never really listened to it. Although I sang sometimes, I never could sing you a jazz pop song. Even though I've heard them, mm-hmm. I just never listened to the lyrics at all. And the same... Go ahead.
I just was thinking it's kind of funny in a way. How we're talking about more of the music, and you're saying, you know, that the words and the lyrics didn't really mean much. And by having you said that, you hear that your son is like one of the most lyrical, artists out there. It's funny. It's like your son took on the same thing that you did, just opposite. Like, he's on the lyrical side, you on the musical side. How did you see that?
Well, that was like odd to me in a lot of ways, because I did appreciate him lyrically, but not as much as his fans do. Maybe because of my son, I heard him say mama and daddy, and they're the most important words he ever said to me, But I still like his music. I can hear things in his music. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm,
the
right.
things that backs up his lyrics, I still have a thing for his in music, how it comes out. And I didn't think I was going to like it when I heard it, but I did accompany him on his first record. I did on sound or whatever on his first record, and I just liked the idea that he was musical.
Mm-hmm.
And I also enjoyed the things that he talked about. I didn't think I would, but since I listened, not much of it, but some of the things, it made a lot of sense, because he told stories about the family and things like that when he was a kid, and I thought that was kind of unique, because the things he was saying, I knew he was saying the truth, and some things he was saying that people would not understand unless you knew what he really was talking about. I did know what he really was talking about, and it made a lot of sense to me, because it was reality to me. Yeah, even though if I didn't think that he should have said some things he said them. Without worrying about what I was going to think about them, what the world was going to think about them. He said them because that was really him.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. That's me as a fan, and I'm pretty sure there's a lot of others out there that agree. The combination, you've been on a few records with him, and we haven't mentioned his name yet, and I would like to not even mention the name, because if they don't know who we're talking about, they need to go and do some research. But I noticed that each song that you collaborated on with him were very even if nobody knew that you guys were related, father and son, was a lot of feeling in those records that you and
Nathan. They were what? I didn't hear that part you said.
There was a lot of feeling. Like, even if somebody that was listening to those records that you collaborated with, they didn't know the relationship. For some odd reason, the sound of that record, there was a lot of feeling in it.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, like, how was the experience of being able to work, you know, with your son?
It was quite good, let's say this, quite good. It was very natural, and it seemed like it should have happened. And it did happen, and I was very satisfied with all of the stuff we did. We didn't try to use father and son like that, because if that was the case, we would have done many records together.
Right, right.
And people wanted us to do that, but there's some kind of way that we didn't. He's a different kind of man, so am I, and we're the same man at the same time. I never tried to push that, and neither did he. And that was a good thing, because that's the way we really are. The things we did together, a few things we did together, was just enough, you know.
Exactly. I agree.
Yeah.
It seems like it came natural, and it was organic, and it just meshed well, you know. So
yeah,
that was good.
Yeah. We got along very well as people, first of all, which is rare with father and son. You know, I have more than one son, and he's just like a different cat. He's definitely, he's a different type of man. And he got to be closer to me because he was the first one, you know. And we had great understandings from the beginning up until now, you know.
Right. Well, you know, and I could say that you did, you know, you and his mother did a well job. I had the pleasure of meeting him once, and then he was very humble, you know. A lot of artists, you know, it's kind of like you said about the jazz musicians back in, you know, when you were coming up, that were very stuck up and on themselves, and there's a lot of that goes on now. And, you know, he was very humble, you know, spoke as if, you know, I might have met him plenty of times. So, you know, my hat's off to you.
Well, look, I'm happy it happened. Is there a young lady in there?
I'm here.
Yeah, you sounding good, girl. How old are you, about 19?
19? No, I'm not at all.
You're a very young voice.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. And how's your mother?
What was that?
How is your mother?
How old is my mother?
How is she?
Oh, my mother's very good.
That's good. Because she did a very nice job with you, give you such a young voice.
Thank you.
And sweet, too. And Derek, you sound like you have good parents, too.
Yes.
You do, don't you?
Thank you. Yes, I do, actually.
Yeah, I can tell by the sound.
thank you. Yes, I do. Very supportive. You know, my pops had passed away about 3 years ago. I was actually working with my father when I said, you know, when I had the pleasure of meeting your son for the first time. So, you know, that's actually a good memory. And you know, your son was able to, he signed a little piece of paper, because I have a son as well.
Uh-huh.
And believe it or not, when my son was, he's 16 now. He might have been about, I don't know, maybe like 10, 11.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to, you know, your son is one of my favorite artists. I used to play his music a lot, and my son, there was a lot of certain songs that my son liked. So, you know, he actually signed an autograph and dedicated it to my son, so I still had to put away. So, you know, that whole little experience ties in with, you know, like when I think of my father and where I worked at and stuff like that whole thing ties in.
Cool memories. Yeah, I appreciate all the stuff you're saying. I'm happy to get a chance to talk to you people tonight, okay?
It was a pleasure.
Yes. I know it's getting late. You're like one of those that you could just sit down and talk to for hours and hours and absorb so much from you. So we really appreciate you taking out the time, you know, even though it's late.
Yeah, well, look, Yeah, I wasn't so old and tired. I talked to you some much longer, too.
It was enjoyable,
and I appreciate that, the enjoyment of it all, and I can hear your voices and hear the spirits through your voices, and you don't sound like regular people, and I like that. I like things irregular, as you know.
Yes. Thank you. It was truly an honor, sir.
Yes.
Look, yeah, you take care of yourselves. Yeah, thanks, everybody.
You do the same. Have a great night.
Good night.
Again, thanks.
Okay. All right.